acknowledge that.
Good, you've got it.
What?
You know, there's a little icon that says got it. Can't you hit that?
No, it's not. It's not on my screen.
Oh, it's not.
Scott, can you help her?
Sorry, Scott, we've touched it.
There was an acknowledged recording thing, yeah. But then I tried to, so and now this is.
Running around, but I'm like here now.
No, that's just the old. Okay,
we're going to start. There's several people online who have been waiting patiently while people were eating their late lunch. sorry about that. I'm very happy to introduce Andrea Graham, who is spending a month sabbatical with us this month, which is great, and doing her first in-person-ish kind of talk since March 2020. So give her good idea to act in the room. And she's a professor in the Ecology and Evolutionary Biology Department at Princeton. She's also the co-director for the program in Global Health and Immunity and Disease Ecology. And she is an evolutionary ecologist, and she's very interested in variation and heterogeneity in host parasites and diseases. And it looks like today we will be hearing about hosts, immune defenses. So this is Andrea's introduction to us. She has spent time at SFI before, but in the context of some working groups. As a part of the complex time program. So this is her visit as a just a standalone visitor.
All right.
Take it away.
Thank you very much, Jennifer. I'm so delighted to be back at SFI, back in New Mexico, and for enough time to really, I think, appreciate the place more. A month maybe isn't quite long enough, but it's better than a few days. So thank you so much for the invitation to be here. I'm hearing an echo. It probably won't bother me. Are people able to hear me okay? You aren't hearing this echo? Okay, online, it's quiet. So, okay, yes, I'm especially happy to give my first semi-in-person talk for a very long time. So what I want to do this afternoon is for the first half of the talk, sort of give you a sense of what my research program is about, and it really is all about asking why hosts vary so much. And then I will go on to a particular example that explains host variation that I think resonates well with the kinds of things folks work on here at SFI, which is kind of a collective behavior problem. Some of our recent work in my group to understand how T helper cells in mammalian bodies function as an agile swarm. So that'll be the second half of my talk, the piece of my research program that I think might resonate most with a wide audience here. So I work a lot at the cellular scale. As shown here, we can put cells in tissue culture under a microscope. Thanks. Okay, thanks for trying. So I do study cells in tissue culture wells under the microscope, as depicted in the picture on the left, but I'm especially interested in understanding how cell-cell interactions that we observe under the microscope might scale up to the scale of an organism. And you'll see that throughout this talk, that I'm very much interested in the organismal scale, how healthy the host might be. Now, it's semi-gratuitous that I have a northern elephant seal as my representative mammalian organism here, but it's not totally gratuitous because although I have worked mostly on mice in the wild and in the lab, on wild sheep, wild baboons, wild people, I just recently have begun working on wild northern elephant seals. And so it's my first chance to put them on a slide with an actual, you know, I do have a connection. I am working to understand their health too. And the immunological mechanisms that I'm about to talk to you about apply across all these mammals. It's remarkable how conserved across mammalian immune systems these mechanisms apply. Okay. So before I go on, though, I want to acknowledge the collaborative team that I am representing. Past and present lab members on conflicted T cell behavior. The lead person whose work I'm going to be presenting today is my former graduate student, Ed Schramm. He's now a postdoctoral fellow at the National Institutes of Allergy and Infectious Disease, working with Ron Germain and Grégoire Altambonnet. I'm going to really present quite a lot of his work, but a bunch of my other students that I'll call out and the postdoc I will call out along the way have also contributed. Wouldn't be able to do any of this without them. I also collaborate extensively, especially with theoreticians. I consider myself numerate. I very much appreciate the power of the mathematics, but I am not the mathematician, but I collaborate very closely with mathematicians, including a couple at Princeton. And the person who gets underlined down in the collaborator zone is Simon Levin, who is the theoretician that co-mentored Ed Schramm for the work that I'm going to tell you about today. But I want to acknowledge other theoreticians who helped me to think hard about how immune function transcends scales from molecular through cellular, organismal, and up to population, and also to think about the evolutionary trajectories of hosts given how immune systems work. And also, of course, thanks to funding sources. Okay, so it is axiomatic in immunology that hosts vary hugely in their immune defenses and the kinds of immune responses they mount and how well they fight off a given infection. And so just as it's pretty easy to look at all these green guys and pick out slight differences among them and their hairdos and that kind of thing, it's very easy to pick out immune differences in a room full of people, like this waiting room at a doctor's office or this seminar room. If we took a volume of blood from everybody's arm this afternoon and challenged it in vitro with various very controlled chemicals and such, we would end up with a huge array of differences in how our immune systems, even the same cell types, respond to very controlled challenges. So this is, again, axiomatic in immunology. It's super easy to observe heterogeneity among individuals. A little more data-driven way of thinking about that is captured here in a figure from now quite an old paper from Greg Poland and colleagues who are trying to argue that we need a whole field of vaccinomics because vaccine take is hugely shaped by the genetic background of the host in which the vaccine is delivered. So measles vaccines, for example, are most incredible vaccine in terms of efficacy. If you deliver that controlled challenge in vivo to a group of people, you end up with a very wide distribution of antibody responses. These are the sort of titers of antibodies against measles that are induced. And then there's just a histogram with number of people on the y-axis. This is just a particularly powerful, I think, demonstration of how variable our immune responses are, even given identical doses, antigens, everything that comes in the vaccines that can be delivered to everybody. We will all respond very differently. Yes.
How functionally important is that heterogeneity? I mean, and how much is it just stochasticity?
It's functionally very important, although above some threshold, everybody over here will be protected against measles. So, even rather modest titers of measles-specific antibody protect against measles. But these folks are potentially in trouble if there is a measles outbreak. So we do think it's functionally important, but function doesn't map perfectly onto this antibody titer distribution. Then your question about stochasticity. Yeah, it's not only genetics. This person was trying to argue that the genotype of the recipient of the vaccine is a big driver of this. And that's true, but there are lots of other things. There's nutrition, but there's also stochasticity, like when the needle went in the arm, did it hit, you know, a particular muscle type, or, you know what I mean? Like, there's all kinds of that source of heterogeneity too. So it's definitely not all genetic.
Is the horizontal axis linear in the antibody level, or is it some other scale?
It's linear.
Okay.
It's very often log transformed because of the huge range, and also because of the way it's measured. It's often measured using a dilution system that makes especially a log two transformation very appropriate, sort of map well onto how the data are collected. But the data themselves tend to be linear. Okay, hosts vary hugely in immune defenses. And of course, none of this is actually news to you because we've all lived through the past year and a half or so. COVID-19 essentially has made headline news of this kind of variation among hosts in how well they can fight off a given infection, right? We had a newly emergent virus that right from early days, this is actually very early on in 2020, this science paper by Matthew and colleagues, mapping out just how variable people were in their capacity to fight off this newly emergent virus. And I'm not going to talk through all the details. It's a doozy of a paper, but I think their initial observations have been borne out that whether it's genetic, again, there are multivariate reasons why hosts might vary. It's genetic, there's age, there's sex, there's dose of incoming virus seems to also matter for how sick people get when they get this nasty coronavirus. But what's been borne out is that the immunocompetence of individuals varies hugely due to all those factors and really can predict COVID-19 severity. So it was headline news in Science. It was headline news in the New York Times. This is just one of the many quite well-grounded immunology articles that appeared in the New York Times in 2020. Again, just mapping mild versus severe COVID-19 cases onto the induced immune response and trying to unpack the contributions of this host heterogeneity and immune response to the heterogeneity and how sick they get. And I've done some work on these aspects of COVID. I'm not going to talk more about it today, but I'd be happy to talk to folk if you're interested in hearing more about the heterogeneity driving COVID-19 disease severity differences.
Sorry, one more question.
Yes.
Has anyone shown, I'm sure there's theory papers on this, but empirically that more variable populations are more robust to transmission infections like COVID?
Yes, not for COVID, but when immunogenetic diversity is high in a population, odds are somebody in that population will have what it takes to fight off a particular pathogen. That's been shown. There's a lot of theory on that, but it's been shown for MHC, major histocompatibility complex diversity in some wildlife populations in particular. But we're a long way from answering that for COVID, I would say. Okay, so hosts vary hugely in ways that matter for our ongoing pandemic. Here's what I want to do with the rest of my talk. It's really in two big sections and one small section. So first, I want to talk about immunological variation from my very idiosyncratic perspective, sort of so you have a sense where I'm coming from. And it really has to do with how many worm infections are in the world, okay? So this is really my hello, SFI. This is my research program. I think about immunological heterogeneity, but there's a big worm theme too. So I'm gonna be sure to bring the worms into the picture here. And then the second half of my talk is really about these agile swarms of T helper cells as an example of why hosts vary so much in their capacity to fight off infections. And the reason I think this might resonate especially here is that systems level analysis is really solving some of the mysteries that immunologists working primarily at the molecular and cellular scales have not been able to solve. There are tens and tens of thousands of immunologists working in labs at the bench at the cellular molecular scale, and they're learning lots of great stuff. But you know, the immune system is a system, and the system level analysis, I think unsurprisingly, is incredibly important for shedding light on how and why it works as it does. And then I will conclude with a brief outlook. Okay, so immune systems in this wormy world, this is really, again, so that folk here know what my sort of motivation and worldview is. And worms may not be everybody's favorite study subject, especially right after sushi, but I'm going to forge ahead and try to convince you. So worms are invertebrate animals that live inside mammalian bodies. They're nematodes, trematodes, cestodes. Those are some of the taxonomic groups you may have heard of. They're incredible, beautiful animals in their own right, and they have, you know, their own reproductive ecology. You can see the eggs in this nematode here. They really have colored my thinking. They're amazing organisms. Even a tapeworm can be beautiful when cast in the right light. But they're also really important in terms of global health, because well over a billion people today, plus countless animals and plants, are infected with these worms. They're formally generally called parasitic helminths, but I'm just going to use the more informal term worms. And so Norman Stoll at the Rockefeller in the 40s, looking at things like this bolus of nematodes passed by somebody who was given an anti-worm treatment, he decided this was indeed a very wormy world, with over one third of people having worms in their bodies in 1947. And folks are continuing to update that with the www.thiswormyworld.org. To this day, it's still true. Around one quarter to one third of people have these worms in their bodies. And so even if you don't think worms are as beautiful and fascinating as I do, this is an important baseline condition for people who get other infections. Meaning that if you're actually more interested in COVID-19, fair enough, or influenza, or whatever bug you might like to think about, whatever germ you might like to think about, those germ infections often occur in the context of a worm, underlying worm infection in many parts of the world. So it's an important public health angle. So there are a couple immediate implications of the quite high prevalence of worm-germ co-infection in the world. One important implication is that other parasite species are infecting individuals that are already full of worms, and this can alter the subsequent course of infection. So one big arm of my work has been to understand how worm malaria co-infections, hundreds of millions of people have this, how that affects the course of infection. And one angle we've explored is that because some worms, such as drawn here by the wonderful watercolorist Matilda Luck, hookworms feed on red blood cells, which is exactly the resource malaria parasites need to use. And it turns out that a hookworm co-infection can actually control malaria infection within that host body by out-competing malaria for red blood cells. So delighted to talk to folk about that if you're interested in resource competition between worms and germs co-inhabiting hosts. Another immediate implication is that there are immunological interactions. A host who's full of worms is actually immunosuppressed for reasons I'll outline shortly. And that can actually impair vaccine efficacy. And my graduate student, Liana Waite, recently did a meta-analysis indicating that especially chronic helminth infections are especially likely to reduce vaccine take. Basically, that measles histogram we looked at before, folks with worms are much more likely to be at the low end of the measles specific antibody titer axis. And so this is very important to think about as we're trying to roll out vaccines, including during the pandemic era. Okay, so worms are quite prevalent and they have these interactions with other infectious diseases that may be more likely to kill. But I'm also interested in not just the presence versus absence of worms, sort of the course of a germ infection in a worm-free versus a wormy host, but also worm burdens vary hugely among hosts. This is a histogram of hookworm burdens in children, where worm burden per person is on the X and number of people on the Y. And you'll see that most people have rather modest worm burdens, quite low worm burdens, but there's this very long tail where some individuals are harboring nearly 100 hookworms. And the observed and expected here is just capturing that more often than not, the distribution of worms among individuals in a population follows the negative binomial distribution. The majority of hosts have a very small worm burden, but some small number of hosts have a large worm burden. And so another big axis of my research program is to understand why. When I've worked on the Soey sheep of St. Kilda in the Outer Hebrides of Scotland, we were studying their worm burdens, and we know that every sheep is ingesting tons and tons of these nematodes every day. We've quantified it in their grass. But some of them clear them. They end up with very tiny worm burdens. But there, again, there's this super long right-hand tail where some of the sheep exposed to that same heavy force of infection due to nematodes end up with a very high nematode burden. So big focus of my research program is also explaining why. What are the contributions of immune heterogeneity here? Okay, so as part B of my welcome to my wormy world, I wanted to unpick the most prevalent evolutionary explanations offered for this kind of heterogeneity, and that is that there are both costs and benefits of defense. If defense were cheap, maybe all the hosts would purge all the worms from their bodies. But given that defenses are thought to be expensive, maybe that helps to explain why some individuals end up at the very long tail of the worm burden distribution. Okay, so here, let's now get into some immunology. So resistance, the ability of a host to clear parasites from the body, definitely has its benefits. So for example, in the face of a hookworm, this is now the image that shows you why they're called hookworms. They have these teeth with which they bury into the intestinal wall of the host. In the face of that, a host who can resist and purge that worm out of the body is a host who's not going to be quite as anemic because the hookworm's not going to be eating as much blood. So resistance is beneficial to the host. The immune system can chuck out a hookworm, the host will probably feel better. But resistance itself does have a number of costs. I'm just going to give you a few examples. So resistance is thought to have resource costs. This is a micrograph of the plasma cell that is the antibody secretion specialist of the mammalian immune system. It's the one we all love having when vaccines against coronaviruses are being offered. These will power out your great antibody responses. But the amino acids required for a plasma cell to secrete thousands of antibodies per second for weeks on end, I mean, it's just like an incredible rate of output of antibody. Those are amino acids that the host can't spend on growing or reproducing, right? And so you can imagine immediately a resource-mediated cost that might make it beneficial for the host to not purge all the worms from the body and instead save some of those amino acids for other life history functions. Another example that I work on a lot, immunopathological costs. I think we probably have all heard of a lot of autoimmune diseases and inflammatory disorders. The immune system is a very powerful thing. And so the very cells and molecules that help the immune system purge worms from the gut can also do a lot of harm to the host itself. So these immunopathological costs, ranging from septic shock type reactions or more fibrotic reactions like COPD, those potentially represent costs of defense that would make it better for a host to not purge all the parasites from the body. Just another cost example. And the third one that I work on a lot is shorthanded as multiple fronts costs. And this is that defense against one type of infection can actually leave the host super vulnerable to another type of infection. And here the example is, if you are one of those people who's really good at chucking worms out of your body, it turns out you're pretty susceptible to germs in many cases. So this is the one we'll concentrate more on when I talk about T helper cell swarming. But I just wanted to mention it here alongside the resource and immunopathological costs. These are examples of costs of defending yourself against infection. So when people weigh up the benefits of clearing parasites from the body versus these costs of defense, There's a famous paper by Yerzy Benki and colleagues where they just intuitively weighed this up and said, maybe the costs of defense help to explain why hosts don't purge all of their parasites. But there have been a number of formal demonstrations since then that yes, indeed, the optimal recovery rate, like evolutionarily optimal recovery rate for hosts exposed to infections declines when hosts pay multiple costs of defense. And this is true even if the parasites are very nasty. If a host is paying both resource costs and immunopathological costs, a very slow recovery rate is evolutionarily optimal. And if a slow recovery rate is optimal, maybe we shouldn't be surprised that hosts are so slow to get parasites out of their bodies, that hosts are slow to purge their worms. Again, just giving you some threads of the research program. Anything anyone wants to ask about, I know I'm talking quickly, but please do ask, continue to ask your questions. But also anybody who wants to talk about any of this in the next few weeks, I'd be delighted. Okay, but I wanna shift now to agile swarms. So this is one example of a cause of host heterogeneity. And in particular, it is a cause of the kind of multiple fronts costs that I mentioned. T helper cells are why being good at fighting worms makes you pretty bad at fighting germs, okay? So it is tied into the first half of the talk in that sense. But it's also mysterious. T helper cell biology seems mysterious in a world full of co-infections, especially by worms and germs.
How coordinated are the T helper cells?
I'm about to tell you quite a bit about that. What do you mean by coordinated though?
Well, you referred to them as swarms, and I'm just wondering if their behavior is essentially independent on large scale, or if there's some information exchange, some kind of signaling dynamics.
Right. Yes, yes. So there is no, yes, there's a lot of signaling, and that's absolutely the crucial thing. There is no boss, right? The spleen is often thought of, oh, that must be the boss of the immune system. No, that's just a bag where cells interact. It's a decentralized autonomous, distributed autonomous system, really, right? So it's not coordinated in the same way that the nervous system is, right? There's no brain analog, I guess is what I'm saying. But there's a lot of coordination in terms of signaling among those cells. And I'll talk more about that now. Okay, so again, the multiple fronts cost that I've already laid out for you. Why do our immune systems impose that kind of cost upon us when a defense is activated? So T cells do a lot of things, and they very much are involved in conferring antigen specificity to defense. So by that I mean T cells along with B cells are the most important reasons why our immune system can distinguish the alpha from the delta variant, for example, or why we might be able to fight off last season's influenza, but not this season's, right? That kind of very fine specificity is very much part of T cell biology. And it's quite a cool phenomenon that I don't really have time to go into in detail, but suffice to say, here's a body, right? Human body. We got tons and tons of lymph nodes in which these cell-cell interactions can happen. And in which the cells of the immune system, here Ed Schramm cartooned them as Mr. T cells, are just hanging out, right? T cells are in lymph nodes. And then this is showing a bunch of germs arriving for some reason around your elbow, okay? So these T cells circulate in and out of lymph nodes, and eventually they bump into these new germs arriving in the body, and some very small subset of the Mr. T cells will be able to bind to that new antigen. It's thought to be about 1 in 100 million has the right receptor to bind this newly arriving germ in your body. And there's a bunch of biology there that we could talk about if you like, but the key that confers antigen specificity is that those rare variants of T cells that can bind that new germ in the body, they proliferate like crazy. You get the amplification of an antigen-specific response, a response specific to whatever is on the surface of that newly arrived germ. And that's all wonderful, and killer T cells do it, and helper T cells do it, but that's not enough. A host can have a perfectly wonderful antigen-specific response, but if they don't do the next thing right, then they will not be able to fight the infection. And it's that next thing that T helper cells really do. The T helper cells then tailor the systemic response so that the parasite killing mechanisms are appropriate to the challenge at hand. And if you think about it for a second, a virus coming into your respiratory tract and a worm coming into your gut are going to be killed by very different mechanisms, right? The things that, like phagocytosis, when a big cell eats a little thing, that doesn't work when the worms are huge, right? And conversely, the weep and sweep strategies to purge those hookworms out of the gut, that doesn't really help against a virus. So it sort of makes sense intuitively that you need some way to tailor the overall parasite killing response to whatever the infection is at hand. And that's exactly what T helper cells do. There's, again, a lot of immunology packed here, but essentially it just depends upon the environment in which that newly activated T cells, so T helper cells are those CD4 positive T cells that you've probably heard about in the context of HIV quite a lot. The cytokine environment, the signaling molecule environment in which those T cells mature, determines what kind of T helper cell they go on to be. Are they going to become a Th1 type cell, which is very good at powering phagocytic defenses? So phagocytes eating things like malaria parasites. Turns out that's really wonderful if you're fighting intracellular microparasites. Is it instead going to become a Th2? That's really not very visible, but that says Th2. That turns out to be really important at activating loads of mucus and stuff. And that's really good at fighting macroparasites, such as the worms that I've been talking to you about. Is it going to become Th17, Treg? Don't worry about those right now. Let's worry just about these top two rows. But suffice to say that for multiple decades now, immunologists have agreed that there are four main flavors of T helper cell, and they map onto different challenges that hosts face. Now, I want to emphasize this is that extra piece. After the antigen specificity piece, which T helper cells also do, this is independent of that. They have to acquire their ability to promote the right type parasite killing mechanism. Okay, so now I'm going to come back to the question about how coordinated they are. I'm going to drill down into these little arrows and think about how a Th1 response gets promoted versus a Th2 response getting promoted. And essentially, this operates much like other signaling systems with which you're familiar. So there are a bunch of positive feedback loops, and indeed that's what's indicated by those little self-promoting loops on this diagram. The positive feedback loops operate as follows. Once a given T cell has converted to a particular type, so here we have a naive one in the presence of a cytokine called interferon gamma. Interferons have also been headline news, so maybe you recognize that. Interferons are really, really good at promoting effector mechanisms against germs and really rotten at promoting effector mechanisms against worms. So if this naive T cell finds itself in an interferon gamma world, it's going to convert to that Th1, that top row in that table in the past slide. And then it starts cranking out its own interferon gamma. So basically the signal it receives in the environment that makes it convert, it then starts pumping that out into its local environment in that lymph node where it's hanging out, and it converts others. And you can go over a series of time steps, really this whole process cartooned here is sort of 12 hours. This would probably unfold. You can end up with a whole bunch of Th1 committed cells. So these positive feedback loops amplify the decision of an individual T cell to a population of T cells, sort of building the swarm, if you will.
Sorry, I missed a passage. Who did produce the initial IFN gamma?
Yes, sorry, I didn't get to that. So this little guy, a dendritic cell, It's an antigen-presenting cell. It's a cell of the innate immune system that is responsible for activating the adaptive immune system, activating T cells, and they are involved in the antigen-specific response induction that I already talked about, but they also are the initial source of those signals, okay? So essentially, this is the boss right here. Not an analog of the brain, so not a boss to the full extent, right? But local boss, this dendritic cell will tell this T helper cell what kind of T cell to become. Yeah, thank you. So interferon gamma production at time step zero is due to the dendritic cell. And how dendritic cells know what kind of parasite is at hand is a fascinating other story. It's sort of how the innate immune system is actually probably much cooler than the adaptive. Because with really low res signals, dendritic cells get a whole lot right. It's quite amazing. Again, happy to talk to folks about that if you'd like. Okay, positive feedback loops power it, but they're also really important negative feedback loops. So T helper cells not only, once converted, start putting out the signals to convince others to be just like them, they actually suppress the activation of those other types. So becoming a type 1 T helper cell means that you are going to try to make everybody else be like you, and you're going to actively suppress the activation of others that are not like you. And so this turns out, and it's a mutual, it's a reciprocal negative feedback loop, this leads to an antagonism between Th1 cells and Th2 cells. Hosts cannot make a strong worm-killing response and germ-killing response at the same time. Okay, so germ resistance and worm resistance are like, there's a mutual inhibition there. Which is crazy because co-infection is the rule, not the exception. I've already told you a little bit about like malaria and worm co-infections. People are really worried about COVID worm co-infections. I have these photos up just to capture one final other theme of my own research, which is I take laboratory mice who have totally clean antigenic histories. They're raised in a bubble. They're the boy in the bubble analogs. And I put them outside, my collaborators and I put them outside. And we find that worm germ co-infections, that's what happens to them. You know, these animals that are outside for only a few weeks, they're co-infected, okay? Now imagine animals, wild animals that are really, you know, outside all the time. Everybody is co-infected. So what kind of immune system do we have that can't multitask in a world full of worm germ co-infections? Okay, so here's where I'm gonna switch to more of the analytical piece, where we propose the colleagues that I'll show photos of in just a moment, Ed and Simon, that collective behavior of T helper cells may help to explain why they polarize into these very different factions, germ clearing or worm clearing, despite the fact that worm-germ co-infection is super widespread. Another way to think about it, I guess, and I don't know if this will sit more clearly, but are multiple fronts costs of defense? This idea that if you're good at fighting worms, you're not very good at fighting germs. Are those costs somehow worth paying in an evolutionary sense over long time scales? Because these swarms that generate factions offer other advantages. And we're able to explore that with some of the mathematics we've undertaken so far. All right, here finally is a photo of the wonderful Ed. He's truly an extraordinary scientist. So he, inspired by the work of Ian Cousin and others, wanted to see whether the biology of T helper cells really mapped well onto the principles of collective behavior. And by and large, it seems that T helper cells do fit the bill. And that's because individuals, in this case, that means individual cells, are limited in their information. You know, they're the one in a millions rolling around in this lymphatic system, you know, and they only know about the parasites they bump into and the cytokines, the signaling molecules that they receive. So each individual cell is limited in its information, just as an individual fish in a school is often limited in its information about where predators might be. Individuals are also autonomous and varied in action. Autonomous, that's that distributed autonomous system idea, right? Each individual cell is independent of the others making its decision. But also they're varied, and I'll come back to that in a few minutes because that turns out to be an incredibly important principle. of this system, it seems. So individuals in T helper cell biology seem to match the expectations for a collective behavior system. And then group behavior, likewise. So basically the group behavior is responding to uncertainties and challenges such as co-infections, sabotage by parasites, because of course parasites have a stake in all this too. Parasites want to manipulate which type of T helper cell response those makes, right? Because it affects parasite fitness too. So the group behavior in response to uncertainties and dangers captured in those clouds up there, the group behavior tends to be fast. This kind of positive and negative feedback loops are thought to make the immune system much faster than it would be without, and also accurate potentially in terms of matching the type of response to the challenge at hand. So again, happy to talk more, but we've also published a couple of papers about that if you want to read more fine print on why we think T helper cells fit the bill. Inspired by collective behavior in other systems, we realize that especially social insects seem to have lessons to offer. So basically the bees had lessons to offer for the T helper cells. And so this is just to remind us all about the wonders of the waggle dance. If a group of bees need to find a new nest in the spring, scouts go out, check out places, and if scouts like what they find, they will come back and waggle to wow others and tell them where to look for this nest site, right? And the idea here is that uncommitted bees can be convinced by good dancing to become a member of the site A proponent faction. And there's also some piping that they do, kind of hooting at the dance floor, if you will, that further amplifies enthusiasm for site A. Conversely, some scouts who really like site B will be dancing for site B and piping for site B. Okay, so there's positive feedbacks as bees try to convince each other, if you will, where the new nest site ought to be. But it turns out that that is not enough for the bees to decide between two nest sites, especially when they're quite similar in quality. There has to be something else too. It's really not too long ago, Tom Seeley and colleagues discovered that the bees are also, again, like humans on the dance floor, they also do a certain amount of headbutting. There are negative feedback loops, so that what's added over here is that in addition to proponents of site A dancing and piping in favor of site A, individuals who are against site A will headbutt as the dance is going on. There'll be some headbutting, some negative feedbacks that are, if sufficiently strong, convince some of the site A proponents to again become uncommitted and then perhaps become more susceptible to the positive feedback loops that push them across to being site B proponents. Okay, so I'm definitely not doing social insects any justice here, but suffice to say that the wonderful waggle dance is not enough for the group to make a collective decision, especially when sites A and B are quite similar. You also need very strong negative feedback. You need the headbutting. And the relative strengths of those negative feedbacks will determine what the group decision is in the end. So I see our time is waning. So I'm going to give you just a few punchlines from what we learned by making a swarm model that's very like the one that helped to explain that bee behavior. So now here Simon appears alongside of Ed. This model bears a very strong resemblance in structure to the bee model, but of course, exactly what they're choosing amongst and what's in the boxes and the amount of empirical support for each of these arrows is rather different. I have to say that we have a lot more data on the strengths of all these feedback loops in immunology than we have in social insect biology. It's really quite extraordinarily data rich. Because I'm not the mathematician in the room, I'm also not going to show you the equations, but we did publish it last year in PLOS Computational Biology, and I'd be happy to go offer you reading material, but also talk to you about that if you like. But this is the structure of the model. And we were able to make some sense of things that had always puzzled cellular and molecular biologists about T cells before. So one thing is, in vitro, when they culture them in these tissue culture wells, they don't make collective decisions. Basically, you end up with these flat distributions. So here's the Th1 end, Th2 end of the spectrum. The T cells are kind of all over the place. They're not making these very polarized commitments to either germ clearing or worm clearing. And it turns out that with the model, we were able to show that only at in vivo densities can T cells make collective decisions. It's like there need to be enough of them to amplify the response sufficiently, to signal amongst themselves sufficiently to make a decision. And so this is the top row is showing the absence of both the signaling and at low cell densities. Basically, here's that dendritic cell, the antigen presenting cell, hanging out with some T cells, and basically nothing happens. Even if there's an infection in the body, there's reason to coordinate a response. Nothing happens if the cells can't talk to each other and if there aren't at sufficiently high densities. Row B is showing where you add signaling. You let the T cells communicate with each other by secreting things like those interferons, but you keep biological cell density low. And you see that they start switching into away from their original color scheme. Maybe you can't quite see that, but they don't develop these factions, these worm clearing, germ clearing factions. At in vitro densities, there aren't enough of them to make these positive and negative feedback loops generate a consensus decision. But the bottom row shows that if you allow them to signal and you pack them in, they can, only then can they flip into either worm clearing or germ clearing factions. And Ed labeled these the information collection, sharing, and decision-making stages. And I guess that this is where they're really just beginning to interact with each other, the cell types. Here's where in the presence of signaling, they can start persuading each other to flip to different effector states. But it's only here that decisions can be made, that the whole population can go worm clearing or germ clearing. So this was not understood prior to, it seems simple, right? Density dependence, but it wasn't understood until a system analysis was done. Okay, and the last piece of our results that I wanted to share with you is that a lot of the data suggested that the individual T helper cells, what they initially decide to do, it's very much under the influence of the interferons from those dendritic cells, but there's more to it than that because space and time and cell-cell variability also affect what decision individual cells will make. So some really careful work by Yanif and colleagues showed that in a lymph node, a signal produced by one cell can only travel sort of 3 to 13 cell diameters, right? So there are constraints in how widespread the signal can get. There's also a bunch of observations of how variable individual cells can be, even if they get the same input, sort of another example of stochasticity driving immune function. So even given the same input, cytokine outputs of cells, so for a given signal received, the signal that they onward transmit spans several orders of magnitude, and this is captured in a lot of very elegant flow cytometry data. But the reasons for these observations, why this many diameters of communication ability, why such heterogeneity among T cells in the way in which they express these signals, those are not understood, especially whether that confers any adaptive value, whether that helps a host stay healthy. So this is the final piece of Ed's work that I wanted to share. So it turns out that at the organismal scale, if you take those cellular scale interactions and plug them into simulations in the swarm model that Ed built, you can find that the varied T helper cells, So variation among them in their propensity to make really strong onward responses when they get activated in a particular way really is important for tailoring responses to the threat at hand. And it turns out it also can buffer against sabotage, against the risk that parasites want to get in there and manipulate the decision of the T helper cell system. So he did loads of simulations basically of this stage of the interaction. And his motivating questions really were, what enables attainment of the optimal collective decision at the organismal scale, where he defined optimal as the decision that responds to a new infection that arrives in the body while ignoring sabotage. And to orient you to, I'm just going to show you a few panels of results. This is what you need to know. So the Th2 mixed and Th1 are on the y-axis, and killing worms, killing germs, you can think of that as the y-axis. X-axis is time, and these hours really do map onto the real time it takes for these cells to do their thing. So what Ed is able to do with the model, of course, is he knows which antigen-presenting cells have been sabotaged by a parasite to say the wrong thing, to push the system in the wrong direction, versus which ones are trustworthy and when they arrive. And, you know, he can set up the simulation accordingly. So APC instruction, what the antigen-presenting cell is telling the T cells is in the gray. And then the optimal response is in black. And basically here, the optimum is stay at Th1. You've got a germ infection. You've got to fight your germs early on. Ignore the sabotage. Don't flip towards Th2 just because some antigen-presenting cells are telling you to. They may have been sabotaged. Ignore that, but flip when trustworthy antigen-presenting cells are telling you, oh, we now have a worm. We now have a worm. We have to switch to worm. Okay, so that's why that's the optimal track, because it's ignoring sabotage and responding to the new infection in the body. So what he was able to simulate, many, many runs of this, is that if you don't allow any variation among the T cells, like these ones that are all Th1 and going along fighting germs, if you allow them to not vary at all, they will never change. That's this green line, both the mean and median. They will stay forever germy, and they will not be able to fight a new infection in the body. I'm sorry, yes.
I may have missed it, but did you say what distinguishes the sabotage APC, what property it is that reveals them to be sabotage versus the trustworthy? And do they ever get it wrong?
So the sabotage and trustworthy are things that Ed set. Basically, he knows that this is a host who has a germ infection, and at the 80th hour, a nasty worm comes in, right? And so any antigen-presenting cells that are tricked by, for example, a germ, ooh, let's trick the host into making a really good anti-worm response, and therefore we can get on with replication and transmission. He knows that any antigen-presenting cells that are trying to push the system towards Th2 too early have been sabotaged, right? Just it's an artificial construct in this system, right? And then here he knows that worms come in, and so the trustworthy antigen-presenting cells are now saying switch to worm, right? So that's kind of artificial, but
it's time dependent. It's
yeah, it's time and. It is time dependent, yeah. But also, he's controlling the antigen-presenting cells and letting the T cells respond, mm-hmm. right? So it's the in silico T cells that are, in this case, totally ignoring all sorts of antigen-presenting cells because they're only doing exactly what they were doing at time stamp zero. But it's when he introduces heterogeneity among those T cells in their propensity to respond to and propagate signals, that's when the interesting things happen. So let me just flip onto the next slide in case that helps. Okay, so this is exactly the same panel we looked at before. Logic is the same for these other two, but what he's done now is he's introduced stochastic heterogeneity among the T cells that are interacting with these antigen-presenting cells. And you can see that with a little bit of introduction of heterogeneity, some of them start, all of them ignore the sabotage, and some of them start committing to Th2 when it is appropriate, the worm-killing immune response. But he titrated in further heterogeneity, and now there's some that might fall susceptible to sabotage, sort of getting at your question, right? But if you look at the mean in dark green and median in medium green down here, sample paths for thousands of these simulations with heterogeneous T cells, you can see that when that level of heterogeneity among the individuals is introduced, they by and large ignore the sabotage, and they by and large, maybe slowly, but they by and large are able to respond to the new infection. So essentially, it's the varied group of T helper cells that discern false from true signals in this system, very closely parameterized to biology, but all of this is in silico, and suggests adaptive value of descent and headbutting to have heterogeneity among individuals in their propensity to follow antigen-presenting cell instruction. Now, we all know this is step one in really addressing whether T helper cells are acting as a swarm, but they seem to have, they meet the basic principles for collective behavior determination. And a lot of this maps onto some insights emerging from collective behavior. Albert will be better placed than I to comment on that, but like heterogeneity in fish schools, heterogeneity in social insect colonies, conferring agility in their capacity to respond to new environments and new threats. Okay, so in conclusion, an immune system that can do all the wonderful things we like immune systems to do. This is just a stereotypical immune response diagram, but the ones I've really talked about today are rapid amplification of an immune response, and then tailoring to promote the right mechanism to kill parasites while not falling prey to sabotage. If you want an immune system that can do that, it seems like you may need swarm intelligence, that the distributed autonomous T helper cell system needs to function in much the way as that bee hive to make the best decision for the colony or for the organism. And Ed is continuing this work at NIH. It's just fantastic because he now can really, really measure these interactions using all the fancy instruments of the NIH. And he's really iterating amongst the computer modeling, the in vitro work and the in vivo work to map the behavior of these groups of T helper cells and to understand the adaptive value of T helper cells working this way, even in a world full of co-infections. So exciting area of work, in my opinion. I think it really does. I don't know if you can see that, but when I was in graduate school, there was this Santa Fe Institute book that came out, Design Principles of the Immune System and Other Distributed Autonomous Systems. This is a very inspiring book for me all along the way. And I feel like only now, thanks to Ed and Simon, am I able to finally analyze whether the immune system, especially the examples I've given you today, meet those criteria. So this is, I really do think molecular and cellular immunology needs system level analysis to fully understand. And so I'm inviting folks to be immunologists and worm biologists too, if you like the worms. So without that, thank you very much for all the great questions along the way. I look forward to more. Thank you.
Any questions from online people? Oh, here's one.
Can you go to the two slides back? I don't get what does it mean you add stochasticity, and is the line is a different realization?
Yes. Yeah. So all these little lines, the kind of faint green, those are different realizations of the model under introduction of stochasticity, and he was using harmonic resonance and various things that probably I would have to put you in touch with him to talk about in detail. But he was introducing it in a very mathematically like easy way or formally rigorous way, and then running lots and lots of simulations. And then these are just the sample paths. You can see that like in this run, these T cells got it wrong, right? They were fooled by this sabotage, right? They were really fooled. Whereas a bunch of these other ones, they didn't even start creeping up towards worm clearing responses until much later. They were more more savvy, but maybe too slow. You know, you can also imagine it stochastically, some of them might have been too slow to really help the host actually fight the worm, right? So that it's the whole spectrum of sensitivities to changing antigen-presenting cell instruction that were introduced with this formal mathematical introduction of stochasticity. Albert.
I guess I have a question that goes back to Jess's question at the start of stochasticity and the distribution in the population. So, like, is it possible that everyone has, like, the same, like, every human has, like, the same system and the same rules, but each instance of the simulation is, like, one patient or whatever, and so, like, you get a lot of variation across the population, although everyone's trying to do the same thing?
Yes, it's very possible that there's a strong element of that going on. Like, for example, that whole measles titer distribution, if we had the same group of people and measured them again, right? Measured them maybe after their booster, or maybe measured them much further down the line, we may see a total flipping of the order and all that sort of thing, right? It may be a moment in time dependent, right? What you observe in terms of measles specific titer may be very dependent upon the moment in time when you look at a given individual. But having said that, there's also a lot of predictability. So in lots of wildlife species and also in humans, there are strong responders. And I'll stick with antibodies since we're talking about that. There are strong antibody responders and weak antibody responders. And you can measure them year on year on year on year, and they will always be at the top end of the spectrum, right? So I guess what I'm saying is that histogram, even though we do think, that was that Thursday, that's what people's antibody titers were, right? But actually, individuals probably stay in a given realm. Like the high ones are probably staying high, even if the exact order might flip around. Middle ones might flip around, but stay in the middle. Low ones, right? So I think what you're suggesting is going on, but there are also host, like organismal scale predictabilities in how an individual's immune system will function. We certainly saw that in the SOE sheep. Like lifelong strong responders who never had any worms in their bellies that we could see, even though they were ingesting thousands of nematodes a day. And then conversely, the lifelong low responders who were always full of worms, and it turned out they didn't live very long.
Okay. Please come find Andrea and talk to her. She's in the office next to mine. And online people who aren't here, feel free to contact her by email.
Yes, delighted to have any follow-up questions that emerge, including if this resonates with completely non-immunological, non-biological things that you're working on. That's why I'm here. I'd love to hear.
Great, thank you.
Thanks.
Yeah, I'm just like waiting for SFI to develop a corporate leadership manual about this, right? You know, you get like, it's like Jim Rutt talks about how he encouraged
corporate leadership. Is that what you're